Please stand, everyone. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the Lord be with you all. In the waters of baptism, Helen died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May she now share with him eternal glory. In life, Helen cherished the gospel of Christ. May Christ now greet her with these words, "Come, blessed of my Father." During her life on earth, Helen received a share in the cross of Christ. May she now share in Christ's victory over sin and death. I now invite Aidan and Marie to lead us in our opening hymn.
Bless all hearts that love thee.
Before we continue with our opening prayer, brothers and sisters, I'd just like to welcome you here to St. Ninian's as we begin this Requiem Mass for Helen Gillen, a long-standing, well-known and well-respected member of our community for many, many years. I would also like to welcome those who are joining in the Mass through the streaming service of social media. Under normal circumstances, I would have expected the church to be full to overflowing for Helen's funeral, but circumstances are what they are, and we are bound by them. So I offer my condolences on behalf of the whole parish community, the many people who would have liked to have been here but can't, to all of you, Helen's closest family and friends, to her children, John, Anne, Elaine and Brian, to her grandchildren, Mark, Stephanie, Sean, Christopher and Melissa, her great-grandchildren, Aidan, Kai, Casey, Parker, Lola, Harvey and Gia. We think too also of her late husband, Tory, who died just a few years ago, and her own brothers and sisters who went before her. Let us pray. O God, who are mercy for sinners and the happiness of your saints, give, we pray, to your servant Ellen, for whom we perform the fraternal offices of burial, a share with your chosen ones in the blessedness you give, so that on the day of resurrection, freed from the bonds of mortality, she may come before your face. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please take your seats, everyone. Our first reading is a reading from the Book of Lamentations. My soul is shut out from peace. I have forgotten happiness. And now I say, my strength is gone, that hope which came from the Lord. Brooding on my anguish and affliction is gall and wormwood. My spirit ponders it continually and sinks within me. This is what I shall tell my heart, and so recover hope. The favours of the Lord are not all past. His kindnesses are not exhausted. Every morning they are renewed. Great is his faithfulness. My portion is the Lord, says my soul, and so I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who trust him, to the soul that searches for him. It is good to wait in silence for the Lord to save. The word of the Lord.
In the shadow of our Lord.
be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, escorted by all the angels, then he will take his seat on his throne of glory. All the nations will be assembled before him, and he will separate men one from another, as the shepherd separates sheep from goats. He will place the sheep on his right hand and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, 'Come, you whom my Father has blessed, take for your heritage the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you made me welcome. Naked and you clothed me. Sick and you visited me. In prison and you came to see me.' Then the virtuous will say to him in reply, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and make you welcome? Naked and clothe you, sick or in prison, and go to see you?' And the king will answer, 'I tell you solemnly, insofar as you did this to one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did it to me.' Next he will say to those on his left hand, 'Go away from me with your curse upon you to the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you never gave me food. I was thirsty and you never gave me anything to drink. I was a stranger and you never made me welcome. Naked and you never clothed me. Sick and in prison, and you never visited me.' Then it will be their turn to ask, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, a stranger or naked, sick or in prison, and did not come to your help?' Then he will answer, 'I tell you solemnly, insofar as you neglected to do this to one of the least of these, you neglected to do it to me.' And they will go away to eternal punishment, and the virtuous to eternal life." The Gospel of the Lord. I'd like to take your seats once more, everyone. I heard a story many years ago now about a time the Queen was due to visit Glasgow. I don't know what the occasion was. But anyway, as it was with these royal visits, many people planned to line the route to get a glimpse of the Queen. And one family who planned to go had a small boy of about 4 or 5 years of age. His mum and dad were quite excited about the Queen's visit, and they spoke a lot about it, with the result that he got quite excited himself, because he could sense that this Queen that they were talking about was someone or something very important. So on the day of the visit, they found a spot where they'd get a good view of the Queen as the royal car passed. And as the car approached, the dad lifted the boy up so that he could see everything clearly, and he pointed the Queen out as she went by. And once she'd gone, little boy said to his dad, "Dad, was that the Queen?" And Dad said, "Yes, that was the Queen, son." And in a voice full of disappointment, wee boy said to his dad, "But it was just a woman." Now, I don't know what he was expecting. He was too young, perhaps, to fully understand the importance of the Queen. One woman, as far as that little boy was concerned, was very much the same as another. To those who didn't know her, Helen Gillen, no doubt, would have been seen like that, just an ordinary woman. But those of us who did know her are well aware that she was a remarkable woman, a supremely important figure in her own family, a matriarch in the best sense of that word. Helen was born in 1935 to Archie and Annie Casey, and she's lived here in this area all her life, having been in Hill Street since 1937. On leaving school, she worked in the carpet factory in Burnbank for, I think, 4 to 5 years, and then later in the Phillips factory for a couple of years before her children, her family came along. And as was common in those days, a woman would stop working when the children came. But when she eventually went back to work, it was as a school cleaner in St. Ninian's, a job she was to do for many years until her retirement. Ellen met her late husband Tory at a dance in St. Cuthbert's, and it was in St. Cuthbert's that they were married. They remained devoted to each other until Tory passed away just a few short years ago. If I were to single out any one of Ellen's good qualities, it would have to be her faith in God. She was a faithful parishioner here in St. Ninian's since the parish opened. And Ellen's love of God spilled over to the love of her fellow human beings. She would very much have been counted among the sheep mentioned in the Gospel. Ellen saw good and saw the best, or tried to see the best, in everyone. She was sociable, she enjoyed the company of others, and so she not only attended social occasions in our parish hall, the Mirth Centre, she worked hard in the hall for a long number of years running events. She also worked in the chapel house. Ellen, as you know, was a very good cook, and she would be called upon to cook for the bishop and all the other invited guests, usually after a confirmation celebration. This in itself shows how Ellen lived her life as best as she could in the service of God and her neighbour. She was a tremendous example of Christian living. But it's all the more remarkable because Ellen didn't enjoy the best of health for many, many years. And it shows what a strong person she was, that she didn't let illness hold her back. She lived her life to the full. Her faith helped her, especially her devotion to Our Blessed Lady, to the Sacred Heart, and St. Pio. And so, brothers and sisters, today as we celebrate Ellen's Requiem Mass, we pray, of course, for the repose of her soul and for the forgiveness of any sins she may have committed in human weakness. We pray, too, that her faith and trust in God may be richly rewarded, and that you, her closest family and friends, may be helped and consoled by that same faith which was so important to Ellen Gillen. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. May she rest in peace. May her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. Can I ask you now to stand for our prayers of intercession? Brothers and sisters, let us pray with faith and confidence to God our Father, who raised his Son Jesus from death, that he may give comfort to the living and eternal rest to the dead. For our departed sister Ellen, may Ellen, who received the grace of baptism, reap its full fruits as she enjoys the vision of God in the happiness of eternal life. Lord, hear us. For the forgiveness of sin, as we remember with love and affection the life of our sister, may she always be in our prayers as we ask God's mercy to forgive her sins. Lord, hear us. We pray for those who are left to mourn their loss. May they be thinking today not of the darkness of death, but of the brightness of the resurrection, and of the day when they will meet again. Lord, hear us. We pray for ourselves for the grace of a happy death. May the faith of our beloved sister, Ellen, inspire us for the rest of our days, so that we may remain true to the faith which has been handed on to us. Lord, hear us. Father, because you are the lover of life in whom there is no darkness or death, We make our prayers confident that you will answer them, for we make them through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please take your seats once more, everyone. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Be near, O Lord, we pray to your servant Helen, on whose funeral day we offer you this sacrifice of conciliation, so that should any stain of sin have clung to her, or any human fault have affected her, it may, by your loving gift, be forgiven and wiped away through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death, so that we might all escape from dying. As one man he chose to die, so that in your sight we all might live forever. And so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Profess your resurrection.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Ninian, St. Cuthbert, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Joseph our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Helen, whom you have called today from this world to yourself. Grant that she, who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours, forever and ever. Amen. Please stand once more, and at the Saviour's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall live. Just about to distribute Holy Communion, everyone. The way we're doing it these days, to minimise movement in the church, I will come to you. So I would ask those who wish to receive communion to remain standing, and those who are not going to receive communion for whatever reason, please remain in your seats. Let us pray. Please stand once more. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that your servant Helen, who has journeyed from this world, may by this sacrifice be cleansed and freed from sin, and so receive the everlasting joys of the resurrection, through Christ our Lord. As Sister Ellen has fallen asleep in Christ, confident in our hope of eternal life, let us commend her to the loving mercy of our Father and let our prayers go with her. She was adopted as God's daughter in baptism and was nourished at the table of the Lord. May she now inherit the promise of eternal life and take her place at the table of God's children in heaven. Let us pray also on our own behalf that we who now mourn and are saddened may one day go forth with our sister to meet the Lord of life when he appears in glory. Father of mercies, we commend our sister Helen in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Helen in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowships with the saint in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help those who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until all meet in Christ and with you and with our sister forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In peace, let us now take Ellen to her place of rest.